Hi everybody, and welcome to our channel. This is lesson 11 in our series, 3D Modeling for Newbies. In this lesson, we're going to pick up where we left off from lesson 10, our Los Angeles police badge that didn't turn out quite right. Let's see if we can figure out a way to fix our problem. Just a note before we start, this is just one way of correcting this issue. It happens to be my favorite way of correcting it, but there certainly can be other options, and I hope that you try and figure your own way of correcting a problem like this. Make the solution yours. So, we go back to our file where the problem was, and we can see that the components are interacting badly with each other. So let's start from the bottom. We have our base shape. We're okay with that. We then take a look at the ribs and the X's. We like the fact that the X's and the ribs don't interact with one another, yet that combination does interact with the base. It conforms to the shape of the dome. That's okay. When we add in the fan, that's when the problem really becomes apparent. We want the fan to conform to the shape of the base, but not interact with the ribs and the X's. Let's try changing the component properties of just that level. If we change it to subtract, that won't do it. If we change it to merge, that's not the end result either. And of course, subtract low is not appropriate either. So let's just try a few things. If we set the level to merge, and we take our base shape and we duplicate it. Take that new duplicated base shape and move it to the level of where the fan is. We're going to take the fan and bake it together because I'm happy with the way it is. And we're going to add that fan to the new base so it conforms to the shape. So you see the fan is bending. The property of the fan level is set to merge. I can adjust the fan shape height or base height appropriately, making sure keeping in mind the thickness of our material. One more little detail to think about. Not only how the components interact, but how the levels interact. Now we have the ribbons, and you can see it's the same problem. So if I change the property of that level to merge, it still isn't going to do it. So we probably should do exactly what we did before. Make a copy of the base. Move it to the level of the ribbons. I like how the bottom ribbon looks. The components fit very well together, so I'm going to group them together as one unit. I'm going to change the property of the middle ribbon to add, because I want it to conform to the shape of the base. And the top ribbon, I'm going to again set them to merge, and I'm going to group them together. So I still have all my individual pieces if I needed to change them, but now they all conform to the base shape because each group is set to add. I can go in and change parts of the individual components if I need to. adjusting it to fit within the material, or simply adjusting it to make it look the way that I want to. So the ribbons look right. Let's change the level to merge and turn on the other levels to see if my solution works. The fan. The ribs. And the base. So the only problem right now is the top ribbon and the fan. It's not that they're interacting incorrectly, I just need to raise up the ribbon slightly so it sits above the fan. And there we have it. Each piece is independent. Each piece acts correctly based upon the design that I want to see. We have the base at the bottom, the ribs and the X's, the fan, and then the ribbons on top. So, this was what it looked like before. Certainly not appropriate or acceptable. And this is the after result. Just by manipulating the properties of the levels made the big difference. So then let's continue. The next is rather easy. Again, as I started off with this lesson plan, learning how to draw vectors is paramount. The building, I simply traced it and I made a component of the building shape, going through with the rounded edge of the building. Limit the height of the component. The windows, they get to be a little tiresome. Drawing the vectors, copying them, pasting them. So here's one way of doing it. I can create my vectors for the bottom row of windows, and I drew a few horizontal vectors. I then want to copy them along that vector. It's quick and easy. And if you do your math correctly and look through the measurements, you can place them pretty accurately. Same thing with the second row of windows. Simply change the number of copies you want and hit copy. If you attempt to do this badge, take your time, because there's a lot of windows. But here's a little trick I wanted to show you. We have one of the rectangles at the very top. I'm going to mirror them four times, so I have a total of five windows, or five rectangles. I place the rectangle that's on the right in the correct position. I choose the five rectangles, and then I use alignment tool of spacing them evenly between each other. So the first rectangle will stay where it is, and the last rectangle on the right will stay where it is, and the others will be spaced appropriately. Again, a nice little trick to have. The rest of the shapes are similar, just drawing vectors, copying them, mirror them around the center. It's one of the reasons I use my X, Y in the center of my material, just for the drawing purposes. Not necessarily for when I run it on my machine. Now, here comes an option. You could create a component for these windows, a negative component, so the windows are recessed into the building facade. I don't know if I would do this in real life, though, simply because the time it's going to take for you to run your 3D toolpath just to create the windows could be extremely long. It might be better to take those vectors without that component and use a pocket toolpath for each little window. I don't know, I haven't tried it, but it's something to consider. I chose to create the component simply for visual effects. The seal of the city of Los Angeles is simply the vectors from an image I found online, and I use the trace bitmap. I'm not going to create components for each of those little pieces. They're just too small. I think it would look better if they were V-carved. So, the trace bitmap worked okay for me. And of course, the wording. Just choose a font that's appropriate, draw some arcs, and place the wording on the arcs. Check to make sure they're lined up and they look appropriate. And then you're off to toolpathing. So this is the end result of the toolpath preview. I will have another lesson in the future on generating the toolpaths for this and actually cutting it out on my machine. But I think we've done pretty well, and I have great confidence that you've learned enough throughout these lessons that you could duplicate this process. I want to thank everybody for watching. I hope you've learned a little bit, and as I said earlier, you've gained now the confidence to create your own 3D models. I look forward to seeing what you have to offer. I'll be back with some new lessons and new projects and new concepts. If you need some help, send me an email, mm@mezalick.com. If you want to see what I'm coming up with next, make sure you subscribe.